Hello, I'm Mary Ito, and welcome to CRAM. Thanks for joining me as we explore new and innovative research and big ideas that may actually change the way you think and act. Well, if I said the word statistics to you, would you clap your hands with glee or head out the door? You might think statistics and you are like oil and water. They just don't mix. Well, surprise. Stats are an integral part of your life. Think about it. You compare today's temperature with the average this time of year. You think about the rising cost of food, the difference in your bills from month to month, and how much your commute time has increased over the years. And nowhere has the importance of statistics been more obvious than during the pandemic. Daily COVID case counts, the number of deaths, vaccination rates, they all became an accepted and expected part of our lives. So maybe we should get to know and understand the world of statistics a little better. Jeff Rosenthal is a professor of statistics at the University of Toronto. He's also the author of Struck by Lightning and his most recent book, Knock on Wood. Hi, Jeff. Thanks for joining us.
Hello. Thank you.
Do you know, many people have paid very close attention and even been obsessed with COVID stats. And yet they say, oh, they hate statistics. They find them boring. Why do you think that is?
Well, those are two different questions, I guess, of course, because statistics have been so important during COVID because they tell us how things are going with the virus and what steps we need to take and how the steps we have taken, whether they're helping or not, and how much vaccines are helping and so on. But in terms of why people don't like statistics, yeah, it is unfortunate that a lot of people have a very negative experience if they take, you know, one class in statistics and they find it hard and confusing and they don't really see the point of it. So I think that's somewhat to do with the way it's taught and maybe it's kind of confusing and they don't really see all the benefits of it. So in my books, I've always tried to reach out to a broader audience and explain to people without getting bogged down in a lot of technicalities why it's so useful and important.
Yeah, I mean, you love numbers. Where do you find the beauty or even magic in statistics?
Well, I guess a lot of the magic comes from how useful and applicable it is in so many different areas. So every time you're deciding whether to walk or take the bus, or you're trying to decide whether to take a job or not, or you're following, you know, world situation and politics, or predicting the weather, or looking at the stock market. I mean, there's so many different ways that randomness and uncertainty appear in our lives. And just having a basic understanding of, you know, what the numbers mean and how to interpret them can actually be very helpful.
Yeah. You know what? I'm glad you mentioned those examples because those are kinds of everyday things. And I don't think most of us think that statistics are involved in those decisions. I mean, yeah, even we decide to take an umbrella or not, you know, should we, or do we take that airplane ride or not? Can you tell us how our perception of statistics does play into those decisions?
Sure. Well, I mean, every time you're assessing a risk or a possible benefit, whether you're thinking in terms of probabilities or not, that's still kind of how you're going to assess it. You know, if you're afraid to do something, it's because you think there's a chance that it's going to go badly, or a chance that you're going to get hurt, or a chance that you're going to get killed. And, you know, we don't always assess so accurately what those risks are. But one way or another, that's the, you know, the key thing in our heads is, you know, what's the chance that this is going to go badly? What's the chance I'm going to get killed? And it really all comes down to what are the probabilities of things happening.
Yeah. Give us some examples. I mean, what are some of the things that people worry about, which actually have a very low probability of occurring?
Yeah, well, there's a lot. And I mean, part of the problem is that in our modern media culture, you know, if anything bad happens to anyone anywhere, then that's the front page headline. Everyone thinks it could happen to me next. But I always tell people to think in terms of what I call the out of how many principle. That is, you know, this one terrible thing happened to one person, but that's out of how many millions of people that were fine and that nothing bad happened to and so on. And so, for example, let's say flying in an airplane, a lot of people are a little scared, you know, they've lost control and they're way up in the sky and they've heard that there have been airplane crashes where something bad happens. But the reality is that crashes of commercial airplane flights are so rare that there's something like one chance in 5 million when you take a flight that your flight is going to have an accident that involves fatality. So it's just so unlikely that you really shouldn't factor that into your decision. And yet people do because they're still afraid of it.
Mm. Is it fair, though, that people say, well, if it does crash, though, it's probably 100% chance I'm going to die?
Well, I mean, that is true that when there is a crash, then the fatalities are high, but the chance of a crash is very low. And you have to kind of put those two together. I mean, you know, it's true if you're, let's say, riding your bike, maybe there's bigger chance you're, you know, let's say you're learning to ride a bike, you might fall and scrape your knee, but you're not going to die probably. And so you do have to balance out the chance that an accident happens and the chance that it's a serious accident if it does happen. And with planes, it's true that if there is an accident, it might be serious, but it's so unlikely to be an accident in the first place that you really shouldn't worry about it.
Well, what about making decisions based on our likes and dislikes? You know, is it possible to use statistics to figure out, okay, what are the best options here? Which one should we go with?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, whenever you're making a decision, like, you know, one example I use in the book is you're planning your wedding and you're trying to decide if you should hold it indoors or outdoors. And you think, well, outdoors might be really nice, but ooh, what if it rains? Then that'd be worse. So you're sort of assessing, you know, the probability it's going to rain, but also you're assessing what's sometimes called your utility, or in other words, if it does rain, how bad would that be? Or if you have it indoors, how good or how bad would that be? And I talk in my book about how you can actually assign numbers to those things. This is what we call your utility function, where you say, well, if we have a nice outdoor wedding on a good day, you know, that'll be plus 1,000. But if it rains, that'll be, you know, a mess. That'll be minus 150 or whatever. And you can make different rules. And then you can combine those assessments of the good and bad with the probability that different things are going to happen. And then you can make the best decision. You can say, on average, is it smarter to have that wedding indoors and outdoors based on the probabilities and your personal assessment of the good and badness in terms of the numbers?
Okay. But, you know, it's interesting, too, to use these stats to figure out our best options. And you said it's something called utility function. Is that part of game theory?
Yeah, that's right. So it's often associated with the study of economics or game theory, and this idea that you look at people's preferences. Of course, it doesn't just have to be your own. You can assess other people's likes and dislikes, and that could factor into what decisions you expect them to make or which are the smart decisions to make.
Okay. And so is game theory something that you would use a lot of in your work?
Well, I have done some research papers which are specifically about game theory, but I'd say in addition, just for thinking about everyday decisions in life, it can be a good way to think things through.
Yeah, I mean, statistics applies to so many different areas, and you've worked in many different fields as well. I know you've done work in law, physics, business, health, even mortality. What, I guess among those areas, what really struck you as being very interesting work?
Well, there's a lot. I mean, one nice thing about the work that I do is, I get to apply statistical thinking and ideas to all sorts of different subjects, and you know, you don't always know where it's going to lead. You know, one example, you mentioned law. So I was approached by a law professor who wanted to know whether Supreme Court justices in the United States, it was at the time, whether they write their own opinions about cases or whether they get their law clerks to write their opinions. And so we said, well, how could we approach that statistically? People have tried to figure that out in other ways, but we said, what about statistically? So we said, well, we could look at the variability of the writing style from year to year, and there are quantitative ways of working that out. And our logic was, if a judge is writing their own opinions, their writing style is going to be pretty consistent from year to year. But if they're getting law clerks, where they get fresh law clerks every year, then the writing style would vary more from year to year. So we could give each judge a variability score and try to figure out, you know, which judges seem to be using their law clerks more because their writing style is more variable, and which ones seem to be writing their own. And, you know, that became interesting. It led to a number of follow-up papers. It got mentioned in the New York Times. So, you know, you never know where these things are going to lead.
Okay, so what was the conclusion of that?
Well, it depended on the judge, of course. And we could say that certain judges seem to have more reliance on their clerks than others. And to some extent, that was consistent with what people had speculated by other means. And to some extent, it provided new insights. And we, you know, we didn't want to say definitively that this judge for sure is using their clerks, because there could be other factors involved, but it was suggestive and it was interesting and it helped to further the debate.
Yeah, I think, see, that's an interesting point you bring up as well, because maybe people assume that if statistics are being used, you know, numbers are the cold, hard facts and it's very conclusive. But in fact, it's not in some cases, right? That you have to, I guess, make certain assumptions using the statistics. And there are also, as you say, other factors involved which might influence the outcome.
Yeah, well, statistics is all about uncertainty. In fact, I sometimes call it the science of uncertainty. And it's all about, you know, probabilities and assessments of things. So, you know, any proper statistical analysis will never say we're 100% sure that this is what's happening. It'll say that the evidence suggests this, or here's the probability that that's happening, or here's the extent to which we can rule out this other hypothesis. But it's never 100% definitive. That's why we need to do more studies of things and try to narrow in on them too.
Yeah, and you've also worked in the area of gambling, which I think a lot of people would be interested in. Can somebody win at gambling just using statistics?
Well, there's a lot of things you can say about gambling. It's a great example of, you know, randomness and probabilities and so on. And one thing I always like to talk about is, you know, why do casinos make so much money, right? Now, whenever we have a debate, should we make a new casino? Is it a good idea? Nobody ever says, what if it doesn't make any money? And yet every bet at a casino is random, and, you know, you might win, you might lose and so on. But as you probably know, the every game at a casino, there's a small house edge, right? So it's pretty close to being a fair game. Otherwise, it wouldn't be any fun. But the casino has just a little bit more probability of winning than the customer. And then the key is there's something called the law of large numbers, which says that if you repeat experiments over and over again, then those probabilities become more and more important. So, you know, take...
Let me just stop you there. Sorry, you said, though, that to start with, the casino has a slight edge in its favor. Why is that?
Yeah, so that's the way the games are designed. So, for example, let's take roulette, where if you bet on red, then you have 18 chances out of 38 of winning, 18 of the 38 slots. And that's just a little bit less than 19 out of 38, which would be 50-50. So it's just a tiny bit less than a 50-50 chance. And so if you just bet a few times, you know, you might win, you might lose. It's really hard to say. But then if, you know, thousands and thousands of people are making thousands and thousands of bets over and over again in the long run, then some of those people might win a little bit, some might lose a little bit. But the casino is always going to come out ahead. And the reason is because they have this slight advantage, a little bit less than 50-50 for the customer, or a little bit more than 50-50 for the casino. And that means over the long run, the casino is for sure going to make money. And that's why they make lots and lots of money. So that's one way to think about gambling.
Oh, okay. So then would the rule for gamblers be don't bet a lot? If you're on a good streak, just don't keep betting.
Well, yeah, I mean, if you're thinking of just if you're, you know, a gambler playing a game of chance like roulette, and you know, the smartest thing to do really from the point of view of making money is not to bet at all. And if you want to bet for fun, that's okay, but you should just bet a little bit. Now, the original question you were asking about whether there is ways to use statistics to make money. And the answer is that most games at the casino are just purely random. So all the statistics can do is explain how quickly you're probably going to lose. But then there are some games where you get to make some choices. So, I mean, for example, if you're playing poker, not just video poker, but actual poker, where the house takes a little cut, but then aside from that, it's all about the strategy. So you could imagine if you're good trying to make money that way. There's other things like, for example, people talk about counting cards, right? And you've probably heard that in something like blackjack, if you, if you monitor how the deal's going and you count the cards, then you can realize because of how many cards are left in the deck that it changes the probabilities a little bit. And if you do that really carefully and you combine that with making good strategies for how to play blackjack, then some people have managed to turn the odds a little bit in their favor, and they've managed to actually make money in the long run playing blackjack. And of course, whenever casinos find out about this, the first thing they do is they kick you out of the casino because they don't want anybody doing that. But if you're really good, so people have found ways to use statistics to try to make money just in certain cases on certain games. But for the most part, there's a house edge, and in the long run, you're going to lose money.
Do you happen to know which game is the most, well, which game would the odds be most in your favor?
Yeah, well, of course, in none of the games are the odds in your favor, but the one where it's closest to being fair of the standard casino games is actually the game Craps, that you might know, where you repeatedly roll a pair of dice and look at the you know, the sum of the two numbers, and it's got these complicated rules. You may know that on the first roll, if you get a 7 or an 11, then you win, but if you get a 2 or a 3 or a 12, then you lose. But if you get some other number like a 4, then that becomes your point value, and you keep on rolling until you either get another 4 and then you win, or until you get a 7 and then you lose. So kind of these complicated rules. So why would they have such complicated rules? It's because when you work it all out, your chance of winning is about 49.29%. So just barely less than 50-50. So that's the one's actually the closest to being 50-50. But it still means if you play it over the long run, then it's going to be more and more certain that the house will win money and that you'll lose money.
See, this is all a great education for people. The next time they walk into the casino, right, they'll just look at things very differently from before knowing all this. Or maybe they won't.
Maybe they won't. Some of them will, maybe.
You know, what about applying statistics to sports? There was the recent Summer Olympics, and I know that prompted you to think about a solution to this longstanding problem.
Yeah. So, I mean, sports and statistics have a long history, and I've done a few projects related to predicting sports or analyzing sports. But yeah, the specific thing you're talking about is to do with the issue of false starts in the races. So when they have, say, the 100 meter race, then they sort of wait till everyone's in position, and then somebody has a starter gun and they see when everyone's in position and then they fire it. And that means people can start. But then they say there's a problem that runners can try to anticipate in the sense of getting used to how that starter works and maybe making sure they're the last person to get in position and thinking when they get in position, they just know it'll be, you know, half a second and then the starter gun will fire. So they can, so you're still not allowed to leave before the gun fires or you'll get called for a false start. But they've actually extended that rule and they say if you leave within 1/10 of a second after the starter gun fires, that's still considered a false start. And their logic is,
that doesn't make any sense to me, Jeff, because you're leaving after the gun was fired.
Exactly. So their logic is they say, well, you know what? Nobody could ever react that quickly within 1/10 of a second. So if you do, that means you actually anticipated. You actually use an unfair advantage to figure out when the guy was going to fire the gun. And, you know, like you, it never sat well with me because what if someone just has a really fast reaction? I mean, these are the Olympics. You're supposed to be superhuman. You're supposed to be better than everybody else. So do we really want to disqualify someone, which they do now, just because they left within 1/10 of a second after the gun was fired? So my proposed solution is to, instead of having a guy who just decides when to fire the gun so people can anticipate it, is to have a computer that randomly makes the gun sound. And there wouldn't be a very long delay, but there'd be a little bit of randomness in how long that delay is. And I worked out sort of the distribution to say that if you do this much little bit of delay on a random basis, then no runner could anticipate it because, you know, there's not a question of getting to know the style of that guy who's going to shoot the starter gun. It's just a random every time. And it means there wouldn't be an anticipation problem. And so my position is if you made that change, then you wouldn't need this weird 1/10 of a second rule. You could say, look, as long as you start after the gun fires, that's fine. And I think that would be more fair. And it would mean you couldn't anticipate anymore. So I wrote a little web page to do this random firing, and I was a little bit in touch with some people from the university racing team, and I don't know if anything's going to come of it, but if anybody's interested, I think that's the way to go.
You need to go right to the top, Jeff. Go right to the Olympics, and then maybe they'll change that rule.
Well, I'd be happy to talk with them. I mean, I say I've talked to a few people, and I did publish an article in the Toronto Star about it, so I'd be happy to discuss it further with any interested person.
Well, you know, and the other thing, too, that it kind of raises is, sure, that's one thing about the randomness of the gunshot, but what if there are a lot of people in this race? And what about the person who's at the very end from where the shot is fired? Isn't there a little bit of like a slight lag time by the time they hear it as opposed to the person who's closest to the gunshot?
Yeah, so absolutely. I mean, sound travels very fast, but not super fast, not as fast as light, for example. So what it does mean, and I worked this out too, is that if the starter gun guy is at one side and he fires the gun, there'll be a difference of like a few hundredths of a second between when the person closest to the starter gun hears that noise and when the person farthest does. And you know what? Some of these races are decided by a few hundredths of
That's
a second.
Right.
So could make a difference. So with my proposed solution with the computer, you could also have a speaker at every lane, or at least maybe every few lanes, so that everybody would kind of hear it all at once instead of having the starter guy just in one spot over on the side.
Sounds good to me. We need to get the Olympics onto this.
Yep.
And you know, statistics, as you talk about in your second book on luck, it is tied up with our idea of luck. What is your take on people's belief in good and bad luck?
Yeah. So, I mean, I'm often asked when I talk about probability, say, okay, but do you believe in luck? And I always say, it depends what you mean. So there's at least two different ways that are quite different to think about luck. And one is just luck means all the good and bad things that happen to us, which are outside of our control. So if you win the lottery, that's luck. If you get cancer, that's bad luck. And, you know, all these good things can happen. All these bad things can happen. We can't control them. You know, they can be frightening. They can be exciting. And that's just our reality. We can take steps to try to control them by being prepared and being cautious and deciding carefully what to do. But there's always going to be some random lucky factors outside of our control. So of course I believe in that luck. It happens all over the place. But then usually when people say, do you believe in luck? They mean something more, and it's a little hard to pin down, but it's some sort of a supernatural force that maybe, you know, there's karma or there's fate, there's destiny, there's a reason for things to happen. And you see it, for example, in the romantic comedy movies when, you know, if the man and woman, if they pick the same floor on the elevator, that means they were meant to be together. And, you know, all these sort of magical supernatural forces that people believe in, you know, superstitions and astrology and all these things fit into that. And that I don't believe in. And I understand why people do. And so many people do. And it's because we don't like this feeling that things are completely outside our control. We want to have a reason for it. We want to have, you know, it happened because it was meant to be, or because of destiny, or because you deserved it or something. But, you know, there's just isn't evidence for that. And if you try to do careful, controlled experiments, you never find evidence for that sort of thing. So I don't believe it, even though I know a lot of people do.
Yeah. I mean, in your book, you call these luck traps, that you fall into these traps. So if that is the case, how do we avoid them? How do we avoid that temptation to, you know, come up with some maybe magical or mystical answer to explain these things?
Yeah. Well, so when I talk about luck traps, what I mean is reasons that people end up believing these things, even though they shouldn't. And part of it is just this, you know, this desire to want to believe in these things. And that's very strong. But also, you know, if people believe that, let's say, you know, that 13 is an unlucky number. And so, you know, on the 13th of the month, something bad is going to happen. And then if anything bad happens on the 13th of the month, even just a moderately bad thing, they'll say, see, I told you, it's because it's on the 13th, that's unlucky. Whereas if something good happens on the 13th, they won't really notice it. Or if something bad happens on another day, they just won't make that connection. So it's sort of a selective observation or sort of a biased observation where we notice the things which confirm what we believe, but we don't notice the things that don't. So how to avoid that is to be a little more systematic and say, you know, I'm going to keep track of, for example, all the good and bad things that happen on all the different days that they happen, and be fair and not only notice it because it was a bad thing on the 13th, but keep track of them all in a fair and balanced way. And then, you know what, you'll probably find that that actually bad things happen on the 13th no more and no less than on other days.
Well, I know one good thing that happened on the 13th. You were born. And you were born on Friday the 13th, no less.
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, of course, I always knew I was born on the 13th, but only when I got older and started using computer software to keep track of dates for my, you know, calendar appointments, I decided to look back. And that's when I noticed, hey, I was actually born on a Friday the 13th. In fact, my preferred title for my last book was going to be Born on Friday the 13th, which I thought was a good title, but in the end they nixed it. But to me, partially I use that to say, well, I've actually been very fortunate. I've had a very good life with a lot of good things happening. So to me, I'm an example against this belief that Friday the 13th has to be unlucky.
Yeah, you're a walking, living example. Speaking about bad and good luck, when I think about, for example, the news, you know, you're talking about the news and how people might focus on the negative. And generally speaking, though, we do report on negative news items, right? Within, let's say, a newscast, it tends to be more on the negative than more on the positive. Do you think we humans do focus more on that? And maybe because of that, we side towards more bad luck than good luck? What do you think?
Well, I mean, certainly the media or the way in which we receive our news, including social media, plays a strong role in our beliefs. And I'd say, yeah, to some extent, the media focuses on negative because, you know, wars and hurricanes and crashes and so on are more interesting. But also, I mean, just focuses on the more extreme events. So if something really good happens, too, that might be written about in the media. But, you know, it's worth remembering that most people, most days, nothing very dramatic happens. You know, they don't get in a car crash and they don't win the lottery and they don't get a diagnosis of cancer. And, you know, but there's not going to be a media headline that says, you know, hey, today 99.99997% of people did not die and did not have a heart attack and did not experience a crime and did not have all these bad things happen or any good things happen either. So I always think, you know, it's great to read the headlines. That's what we want to know about. But we should also keep track of all the people that nothing happened to. And it's just really thinking about the numbers. I talked about the out of how many principle to say, yeah, this extreme thing happened to these few people, but 99.999 whatever percent of people did not have any such thing.
Yeah. Do you know, I wondered though about our tendency to focus on the negative stuff, right? Whether it's picking out sort of the negative stuff in the news and thinking, oh my goodness, could that happen to me? You know, what are the chances? And focusing on that. I wonder if it also has anything to do with our, you know, our instinct for survival, and that we need to pay attention to possibly bad things that might endanger us.
Yes, I mean, absolutely. And I do sometimes think that, you know, humans evolved in, hunter-gatherer tribes of, let's say, maybe 50 or 100 people. So it meant, you know, if there was news, hey, guess what? Somebody just got, you know, killed in a terrible way by a lion, let's say. Well, that means there's a lion around, and that means you might be next. So that means you better be careful and you better hide or seek shelter or, you know, move on or something, because there's a danger here. Whereas now if you see a headline that, hey, somebody, it was a terrible home invasion and, you know, children killed, all these horrible things we read about. That means one family out of millions and millions of families that live in, you know, the municipality or the province or the country or the world, and that, you know, if something bad happened, it would have been the headline. Out of all those millions and millions of people, in one case, something bad happened. One way I sometimes say that, you know, if something reaches the headline, that's not because it's a common problem. That's because it's so rare. And, you know, there's not a headline that says, man suffers heart attack today. And yet, over a third of us will actually die from something related to cardiovascular disease, heart attacks and strokes. Doesn't make the headlines because it's a common occurrence. Whereas this crazy home invasion, that made the headline because it was rare. So in a way, we should take comfort, the fact that that's the big headline, because it's a very rare thing.
Yeah, no, that's a very good point. Do statistics give you comfort?
Absolutely. In fact, we mentioned flying, and I used to be, when I was younger, a little bit of a nervous flyer. I mean, you know, I'd be looking out the window, make sure the wing's still attached properly, and, you know, if there's a little turbulence, I'd be jumpy in my seat. And when I started looking into the statistics for my first book, it actually was a comfort. I realized it's so unlikely that, you know, this plane's going to actually crash, that even if there's a bit of turbulence or even if there's a bit of rain or something, there's actually nothing to worry about. As I tell people, if you really want to worry about something while you're taking a flight, worry about it being late, because about a quarter of flights are more than 15 minutes late. So that's something that makes sense to worry about. But a crash is just not going to happen.
And Jeff, you're a computational statistician, which means you work with computers. Right. What excites you about where this field is going? You know, I mean, what do you see as the possibilities in the future for this field?
Well, there's a lot. That's a big question. I thought you were going to ask me what excites me when I'm working on the computer. And of course, it's exciting when the computer program does what it's supposed to do. And it's not so exciting when it doesn't do what it's supposed to do. But yeah, as far as the big picture, I mean, it's quite closely related to the whole sort of artificial intelligence, machine learning thing. And, you know, obviously, computers are getting faster and faster and being programmed to do more and more things, and things that they used to not be able to do, like to recognize a person in a photograph or to recognize speech or a piece of music. They now do routinely, and we all speak to our iPhone to get it to do things for us. And, you know, the computer checks our fingerprint to let us log in. And so it means, like, for example, things like surveillance. You know, if there's a security camera somewhere, it can automatically figure out if a certain person has been there. You don't need to look through hours of footage. So it means that computers are influencing society in many ways. And, you know, the algorithms behind them are very interesting, and they use a lot of probability and statistics and all that, you know, matching patterns and different ways of modeling these very complicated things like images. And that's very exciting to me from a sort of professional point of view, but also from a societal point of view, you know, it's both exciting and scary, because it has a lot of promise for things that are much more convenient now than they used to be, and that will continue to get more convenient. But it does raise the possibility of enhanced surveillance and computers more and more making decisions. And, you know, we've all experienced, yeah, can't get into the web page because it doesn't think you're registered, but actually it did register and there's a problem with the web page. And if it was a human, they'd just sort it out. But if it was a computer, they might not sort it out. So, you know, it's affecting our society in huge ways, which go well beyond anything I'm working on myself. But it's, you know, what I work on is somehow related to this idea of, you know, probability and statistics being used in conjunction with computers and what it can get computers to do.
Yeah, I guess that, I mean, that's part of a much larger discussion, isn't it, about what we can do with the technology and all the, you know, ethical and moral considerations around it.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It's a big, big issue.
I want to end off with the absolutely best statistic that you know of, something that is near and dear to your heart.
Well, there's so many. It's like choosing which of your children you love the most. But one thing that I think is an interesting perspective, because it illustrates a lot of things, is there's a a study done, and they said that over half of all automobile accidents take place within 5 miles of the person's home. So you hear that, you think, well, that's interesting. Does that mean it's more dangerous driving around your own neighborhood? And then people get theories, oh, it's because people think they're familiar with their neighborhood, so they don't pay attention, or because they're in a hurry to get home, or because they're just starting their trip and they're not paying as good attention or something. But actually, there's a very simple explanation. It's because most driving happens within 5 miles of your home. That is to say, you know, usually you're making short trips, or even a longer trip has to start near your home. So actually, most of the driving, or at least over half of the driving, takes place within five miles of your home. So of course, most of the accidents take place there too. And to me, it illustrates, you know, how we have to think about, you know, if you hear a statistic, you have to interpret it properly, but also this principle of sort of out of how many that I've said before, and to say, well, okay, there were more accidents here, but out of how many people who were driving there? And when you start to think about things that way, then a lot of things become more clear, I think.
Thank you, Jeff. You know what? That was a very comforting discussion about statistics.
Great.
Thanks for joining us.
Okay, thank you.
That's Jeff Rosenthal. He is a professor of statistics at the University of Toronto. He's also the author of Struck by Lightning, and his most recent book is called Knock on Wood, Luck, Chance, and the Meaning of Everything. For more information on Jeff and his work, you can check out our show notes. Thanks for joining us.